Have you ever overwritten that data file you shouldn't have? Or deleted that crucial configuration file? Well, I made these kind of mistakes, and I guess everybody makes them. Now, the impact of those mistakes, they range between recreating the file and spending hours and hours to recover it, or restoring a previous version from a versioning system in a few mouse clicks, and in a minute or two, you're back on track. Today, I want to introduce you to versioning, where we can avoid this kind of mistakes and easily recover previous states of all your files. We will look at the two major versioning systems, Subversion and Git. We will install and use them in a simple environment that is suitable for 90% of all data scientists. Let's dive in. So we want to use versioning to improve our data workflow. We want to reduce the impact of the mistakes we make by accidentally overwriting files or deleting files. But what is versioning? Versioning is nothing more or nothing less than a database that keeps track of all versions of your files. The version management system will allow you to go back in time and to recover any version of your file you created in the past and, for example, compare it with the current one. When we look at the slide, we can see a demo setup consisting of two laptops used by the data engineer or the data scientist and one production server. All three need to have the last version of your data flows and your config files on the machine to work on. They will be all three consulting the repository. The repository is a central database containing all your files, including all versions of your file. Now, when the data engineer or the data scientist on the first laptop, he starts working on a project, the first step he has to do is to check out the repository on his local machine. The checkout is a copy of the last known version of your data flows and config files, and it's copied to the hard drive. The data scientist can create new flows or he can update flows, and when he's satisfied and everything is tested, he can write the result back to the central repository so everybody can use the last version. To do this, he needs to do a commit. So committing is to write back the result to the central repository. Let's assume on the second laptop there's a data engineer working. He starts on the project, so his first step is to check out the code to his local hard drive. He makes, for example, some changes to the data flow, optimizing the data flow, and when he's satisfied and everything has been tested, he can commit the result back to the repository. At that moment, for that file, the last version in the repository is not anymore the same as the one that's on the first laptop for the data scientist. The data scientist can update the local copy by asking an update. Basically, the update will look at the local copy and at the repository, and it will compare which file needs to be updated, and it will update those files. The production server, we assume nobody's working on the production server, so it will not do commits, but it has to get the code repository on the hard drive, so the first time it's the checkout, and on regular times it needs to do an update to get the last version of all flows on its drive. When we look at the repository, this one can be organized in different ways. It can be as simple as a drive on your local hard drive. Of course, then you can't collaborate with others. It can be stored on a shared drive used by the whole team, or even on an external server in your network or in the cloud. For example, GitHub is a repository that's in the cloud. If we go look at the repository itself, we will always see the last version when we do a simple checkout or an update. But when we dive in, we can also see all the historic versions of that same file, and every change that has been made or has been published will be visible here. So if you have a basic workflow, it would be the same V1, V2, V3, but here in the repository, it will be a timestamp. So to summarize, we have a repository. The repository can be on a local hard drive, on a shared drive, or on a server, local server, or in the cloud. You get your files from the repository on your hard drive. The first time, we call it a checkout. If you want to update it, we call it an update. If you make changes to the files or added new files, you need to do a commit to copy those files back to the repository. And then they will be available for all users using that repository. And basically, that's it. That's the basic setup of a version management system. Now let's have a look at how they do it in practice with Subversion and Tortoise SVN. First step is, of course, getting the software. And the best thing to do is go to the website of Tortoise SVN. So I think it's tortoisevn.net/downloads. Download the right installer. For most people, that's a 64-bit version, and you choose the latest version. Install Tortoise SVN on your system. Actually just go through the setup. It's all quite straightforward. And important, reboot your system, because else the file system integration will not work. When the software is ready, the first step is to create a repository. Keep in mind, the repository is a central database keeping all your files and all your historic versions. The repository is your master database, so make sure that you keep it at the right place. If you choose to store it on a disk, local disk or network disk, make sure the disk is accessible to everybody that needs to have access to it, and that it's backupped. In this video, we will put the repository on a local disk, but it is exactly the same as putting it on a network drive. Creating the repository is simple. You go to the directory you selected, you create a folder, and then you click on the right mouse button, select the Tortoise SVN, and say create repository here. When you click, you get a pop-up, and then OK. And that's it. Your empty repository has been created. Step 2 is creating the local copy of the repository on your hard drive. So go to your working directory, the place where you do your everyday development work or you create your new flows. There, we're going to create a new directory, for example, local project dir. We go into that directory, we right-click, and then we can select checkout SVN. In the files, we select the place of our repository, and we can create the local copy. When we create the local copy, we will see that it behaves a bit different than a normal folder. You will see a lot of green checks, meaning the folder is in sync. Once we start editing in the files, we will see that things there change, and we can see which files are in sync and which files are not. So at this moment, our repository is empty and our local copy is also empty. Time to put in our first file. So I copy in an Anatella flow from another video, and you see the Anatella flow doesn't have the check mark. Of course, the Anatella flow has not been yet committed into the repository, so it's not yet a part of the repository. When your file is finished, or in this case, the copied file is there, we're going to do our first commit. So that means copying your local state back to the repository. You press your right mouse button and you select the SVN commit. Each commit, you have to write a message on the commit, and basically it's a place to tell what did you change or why did you change the project. So for example, I could say here my first commit. But if you're working on a file and you made changes on a specific part of a data flow, you can explain that in the comments. Now, if you jump out of the directory and go back in it, you will see that your new file also has the green check. So that means it's in sync with the repository. So we just successfully committed our first file to our project. Now let's see what happens if we change the file. So we open the Anatella file and we add an extra inline table to the Anatella flow and save it. When we close the Anatella window, we will see that the green check has been replaced by a red explanation. So this means the file has been changed. The change only happens on your local hard drive, not yet in the repository. So when all your changes are done, you want your local copy to be back in sync with repository. To do that, we have to do again a commit. So we'll commit the second change into the repository. And when we do the commit, we will see that our file gets back the green check. Now it's time to look at the power of a versioning system. We had a first version of our file and a second version. Let's have a look at what we changed. To do that, we click right on the file and we select compare with previous version. The Tortoise repository browser will open and it will show us the differences between the two versions. You will see these are not visual representations of our Anatella flow, but the XML version of the same flow. To understand how this flow looks like, I created a different video, which I will link in the description. And when we examine the changes, we will see that in the first file there's a gap, and in the second file a piece of code has been added. So we see there's a difference between the two files. Basically, that's the impact of the edit we did by adding the inline table. Now it's time to simulate you're working in a team. So we're going to do a second checkout on the PC of your colleague. The PC of your colleague does not yet have a first version of your repository, so we need to do a checkout first. When the checkout has been made, we will be creating a new file and we will committing it to the repository. So we create a new flow and we will commit it back to the same repository. After the commit, we will go back to our own working directory. And at this moment, in the repository, there's one file more than in our local repository. So we will need to do an update. After the update, our file is nicely back into our local copy. But you see, the versioning system does not automatically warn you that there's a different version or a different change in the repository versus your local disk, especially when it's on a different machine. So it's a good routine to do the updates on a daily basis. We just looked at how to look at the difference between the current version and the old version. Sometimes you want to get the old version back out of the repository. For example, if you made changes to a file you didn't want to, or something else. To do so, we're going to create a subdirectory named, for example, old. We go into the directory and there we're going to do a checkout, but a checkout on an older version. You can choose between a checkout or an export. The checkout would check out the whole project, while with an export, you can choose which files you want to export. To select the older version, you need to select a revision. So select the revision, click the Show Log button, and select the right version you want to export. So now we have checked out the older version of your codebase, and you can select the right files you need, and afterwards we delete the old directory. We don't want it checked in because that data is already checked in the repository. So now let's summarize. We started by creating a repository. Make sure you put it on the right place and a secure place. We did our first checkout on our local machine in our working directory. We put our first file into the repository and we committed the first file back to the repository. We created an update to the file and we saw that it changes in our file system. And we saw that the checks on the files are changing, and only when we do a second commit, our changes are put into the repository. When our coworker starts working on the same repository and he makes changes, we need to do an update to get those changes on our local machine. The machine was not warned that there were changes, so you need to do it regularly. If you want to look at the different versions of a file system, you can select the compare with previous versions. And if you want to have those files on your disk, you can check out an older version in, for example, an old directory. This is the basis of versioning. It will cover 90% of all your needs, and it's still very simple to execute. So now you're ready to start using it on your most critical projects. This way, you will never lose data again or get a wrong version due to small mistakes. I hope you liked the video. I think this is a great kickstart to start with versioning. If you liked it, give it a thumbs up. If you want to see more, subscribe to the channel. See you in the next video. Bye.